times that every month has a certain energy. That if I tap into this energy, I'm able to derive something from it. More than that, every month has a certain emotion, a certain sense that is dominating. And again, it's something that I can work on during this month, that I have an extra access to it, so to say. So the point is not only to learn the mystical explanation of what's going on in the month, is to derive something out of this month that I'm able to tap into. The example I always give is the Black Friday example. And once a year you have a discount. And if you're well prepared and you have your coupon, then you get whatever you want to buy for 90% off. And if you don't, a minute after the sale ends, then you can get it for a discount. Same in our spiritual existence. Every day there's a certain energy in the world that if I tap into this energy, then I can derive something out of that that will benefit me, that I have to. That's why our time is very important in this world. Same thing every week, same thing every Shabbat, every month. There's constantly a Kadosh Baruch Hu creates the world with a certain energy or a certain godly power. And if I know how to tap into it, to focus on it, that I'm able to derive something out of it that will benefit my spiritual growth, that will benefit my service of God in this world. So if I'm just living my life and I'm going like an autopilot every day, day by day, day by day, and I'm just kind of schlepping the days, then I'm missing the point why I'm here. I have to make sure that every day I live to the fullest. I explained in one of our classes that the second level of our neshama, that is called chaya, it's also called in many Kabbalistic books, tzelem. Tzelem is like an image. How we read in Sefer Bereshit, Betzelem Elokim Nivra Adam, that in the image of Hashem, we were created. In this level of our soul, that doesn't penetrate the body, the chaya and the yechida, they're way too high and way too spiritual to penetrate into the body. So they're around the body, like our surrounding light, what's called an or makif. The chaya is also called tzelem. In the tzelem, which is an image, it has thousands of sparks. Each spark corresponds to one day of our life, which means that if a person died in the age of 80, then take 80 times 365 plus the days of the leap year, and that's the amount you're going to get, which will be 40,000-50,000. That's the amount of these godly sparks that are building the tzelem. And every day I have to take one of the sparks, refine it, clean it, and then elevate it to its source. That's the main reason why we go to sleep. Because I many times ask, why did Hashem create us with going to sleep? It's a waste of time. It's a waste of time, waste of space. If I didn't have to sleep, I didn't need a bedroom. And I wouldn't need a bed and sheets and everything that goes around the sleep. Why did Hashem create the concept of sleeping? Really, it's a waste of time. We sleep a third of our life. So the reason why we sleep, there are many reasons, but one of the main reasons is that's when the soul goes up to its source and delivers what it did and refined in this world. So if I didn't do it today, then like in the cell phone companies, it rolls over to the next day. In the cell phone companies, if you didn't use your minutes or you didn't use your data, the next bill, it will roll over, now you have more minutes. Same idea. If I didn't refine this part of the neshama today, then tomorrow I'll have double. And the next day, I will have triple. And that's why a lot of people, their avodat Hashem, their service of God, is a burden, and it's hard, because they're carrying so much with them. If you do it every day, then you don't have to carry it the next day. That's why it says about Avraham Avinu, if you notice, if you pray Shacharit in the day of Rosh Chodesh, after we read Hallel, in some of the Nosachim, we say, V'Avraham Zaken Baba Yamim. That Avraham was old, it's using the word zaken, old. But zaken means zaken shekana chokhma, that he acquired a lot of wisdom. And then it says uba bayamim. Baba yamim means that all his days were lived to the fullest. He didn't waste a day. He didn't take a vacation or spent a day just doing nothing. I know for us it's hard to relate. I need a vacation. I need to relax. I need to unwind. But the reality is that every day of my life, I have to do something. And if I didn't do it, then the next day I will have to do it. And I have to do this spiritual work till the last day of my life. Now, why is it important to know? Because if I missed sort of the opportunity, I will have to come back here. We're learning now every Tuesday, Shar Gilgulim, the gates of reincarnation. And we just started touching in it that I have to come here and I have to finish my refinement. I have to refine my neshama. And if I don't, then I will have to come back again and finish with it. So I want to make sure that every day of my life is used to the fullest. And one of the ways of helping me do that is when I tap into the energy of the day to be able to take something out of this energy and to use it for my Avodat Hashem. So the same way that there's something like this every day, the same thing is every Shabbat, the same thing is every month and every year. Every year is a total different energy. On Rosh Hashanah, Hashem removes the godly light from the world, what would enliven the world the entire year. And then there's 24 hours that there's, so to say, no energy in the world. The world is somehow sustaining itself on nothing. And then depending on our tshuva, that's how Hashem says, okay, this is the new energy I'm going to bring down to this world. That's why it's called Rosh Hashanah and not Tchilat Hashanah. Rosh is head and Tchilat is beginning. Technically, it should have been called Tchilat Hashanah, the beginning of the year. But it's called Rosh Hashanah because that's when Hashem decides this is what's going to be this year. So the head holds in it everything. So same thing we have with our month. So every month is a certain energy, a certain power, a certain character trait that if I tune into it, it allows me to reach to my potential and my service of God and my self-refinement that I can concentrate on. And if I know how to put my mind to it, that during that month, I'm able to work on it. So, there are different signs about the month. There are 12 months, there are 12 tribes. The tribe of the month of Adar is the tribe of Naphtali, which has a great connection to Tzfat, because that's the area of Naphtali. So it's also very connected to us this month. So the month of the tribe of the month is Naphtali. You need me? The sign of course is Pisces, is fish, is the gim, and which the element of the sign is water. Water has two ways of looking at it. The positive way, the positive part of it, the Talmud says, "En bracha shora ela badavar samui min ein." The blessing only dwells on something that is hidden from the eye. So, since this is the sign of water, and the fish are in the water, deep in the water, you can't really see them unless they come to the surface or unless you scuba dive. So, the positive part of it that this month contains in it an unbelievable power of blessing. The negative part of it is that water, the element of water, is what's birthed all the teavot, all the desires, the negative desires. So it has two parts to it. That's why even the sign, you have two fish. This is not the same idea of the sign of twins. This is separate. It means when we see the sign has two fish, it means that there's a very dominating, a very harsh separation in this month. The energy can be directed very strong to the positive side or very strong to the negative side. So the sign of the month is Pisces and the element is water. The star that controls the month is the star that is called Tzedek. Tzedek has one letter in it that's the letter of the month of Adar, which is the letter of Kuf. Kuf is, again, is a very special letter. The same idea of the month of Adar, that it has a very powerful separation between the good and the bad. Because Kuf, can look at it from the word Kadosh, holy, but Kuf also has a very negative character trait. It's the only letter that the leg of the letter goes underneath the line, which means that it has some type of a connection into the Klipa, into the world below, that can be pulled something from a high level into a low level into the Klipa, which means that there's a connection into the in this letter. A, it's above the surface, so it can have a good connection to something positive, but it also can be directed into something extremely negative by pulling me into the klipa, into the impurity. Now, the letter Kuf, also we're going to talk about it later, because that's one of the most powerful things of the month. There's a certain action that we do in this world that is extremely negative, and that's called a lie, Sheker. Which I constantly repeat, how it's one of the most worst sins one can do is to lie. And the center of this letter, of this word, is the letter Kuf. How you write it is Shin Kuf Resh. And the center of it, the core, so to say, amen, is this letter of Kuf. We're going to get to that. Now, in the book of Yetzirah, the book of formation, that it's considered the first book of Kabbalah, that we know that Adam HaRishon, Adam, he got the information, but this book is more connected to Avraham Avinu. Avraham Avinu is the one who compiled it. So it says there with which letter each month was created. So the letter that created the month of Adar is the letter Gimel. And Gimel stands for the word Gomel Dalim. Gomel Dalim, Gomel is to give, and Dalim, somebody who is very poor, is called Dal, very diluted. Hashem has an attribute that is called Gomel Dalim, that He gives an abundance to somebody who doesn't have anything. Gomel Dalim, if you look at the words, Gomel starts with Gimel, and Dalim starts with Dalet. If you take the Rashei Otiyot, the first letter of the word, it's called Rashei Otiyot. So you have a Gimel and a Dalet. Gimel and a Dalet, if you switch the words around, the letters around, then it will form the word Dag. Dag is a fish. So, if you know the actual verse, it says that and the Kadosh Baruch Hu, that he's Gomel Dalim, and he's also Somech Noflim. This is the same verse. Somech Noflim is somebody who falls, then he kind of picks them up. Somech Noflim, if you take the Rashi Otiyot, has Samech Enun, then you can make the word Nes out of it, which is a miracle. That's why the month of Adar is a very powerful month for miracles. So, what I want to take from that is that the month, what the power, the letter that creates the month, first of all, it creates the word Dag. Dag is a fish. Fish dwell in the water. The water, if it's directed to a positive place, then it's a sign of bracha. The Baal Shem Tov says, everywhere you travel, you see water, you know that there's a bracha there. When water spills, it's a siman for bracha, it's a sign for bracha. Water, if it's directed in a positive way, it has the power of growth. Take now a plant, doesn't matter what type of plant it is, if it doesn't have water, it will never grow. So water has the power of growth. On the negative side of it, the water can birth all the teavot, all the negative desires. So the month of Adar has the power of growth, has the power of bracha, and also has the power of nisim, of nes, of a miracle. If I just sit like this, then I will not get any bracha, and no miracle will happen. But if I actually do some type of an action, this is a very powerful month to bring on me an extra bracha and an extra power of miracles. Now, again, we said that the letter Gimel is the letter that created the month, but the letter Kuf is the letter of the month. So I mentioned before that the Kuf can be directed to, again, positive and the negative. This is the one of the elements of this month, is that it has a very obvious way that you can direct your entire energy to the positive and direct your entire energy to the negative. The one of the signs of the letter Kuf is that it's only standing on one leg. I mean, the letter He has two legs. Many, like many other letters, they will have a base, like a bit. Gimel will have also two legs. Kuf only has one leg, which again can be directed into a very positive way and can be directed into a very negative way. The negative way is that the Kuf can pull me into the Klipa, into the impurity. So I have, as much as I have the power in the month of Adar to elevate myself into a level of holiness and Mabracha, if I direct my energy the complete wrong way, it has the power to actually pull me down into the even more of impurity and the opposite of purity. Now, another character trait in the month of Adar, the original calendar starts, the Rosh Hashanah is Nisan. If you remember from the class we had on Tu B'Shvat, I told you that there are four Rosh Hashanah. So Rosh Hashanah that we celebrate on Tishrei is one type of Rosh Hashanah. And then we have the Rosh Hashanah Leilanot, when we celebrated Tu B'Shvat. But Rosh Hashanah L'Chodashim, the head of the year, of the month, that's Nisan. So really, if you see in a lot of times in the Torah that it's talking about month, the calculation goes by Nisan. So for example, when they got the Torah, when it says in the B'Chodesh HaShlishi, if somebody goes by Tishrei, they will calculate Tishrei, Cheshvan, Kislev. But it's going by Nisan. So it's calculating Nisan, and then as the Rosh Hashanah. So the biblical term of the biblical calendar, so to say, starts from Nisan. So what does that make for the month of Adar? That makes it the last month. The last month, because Nisan will be the first one. So the Rosh Hashanah, the head of the year for the month, is Nisan, Rosh Hashanah L'Chodeshim, which makes Adar the last month. The last month will correspond to the Sfira of Malchut, that the Malchut is just the receiver, meaning that the month of Adar is receiving everything from all the rest of the months, meaning that the Adar has the power of all the months of the entire year, holding the power of all the months together. Why? Because that is the last month of the year in regards to the biblical calendar. The benefit from that is that all the energy, all the what's called hamshacha, the power, the enlightenment that I got from the entire year, funnels into the month of Adar. That's why if I'm directing my energy to the positive side, I can derive the bracha, the blessing and the energy from the entire year, from everything that I did from the entire year. So the month of Adar has the power, the capacity to hold this unbelievable bracha that will cause that will cause the energy of the month to create an unbelievable miracle. That's why it's also considered the month of miracles. Meaning that if I tap in to the positive side of Adar, I have an unbelievable ability to get this unbelievable blessing on Adar. That's why we know that the month of Adar has a special blessing, that if I have a lawsuit or any type of trial or any type of argument, it's a very good month to deal with this. Anything that I have to deal with that I need an extra boost, Adar is a very good time to do it. Why? Because it's already holding in it the energy of the entire year. Now, I always like talking about the motion or the sense of the month. Now, the sense of the month of Adar is the sense of laughter. But, like I said before, the month of Adar has a very strong separation between the negative and the positive. Laughter can come from a very negative place, and that's when I have, you know, the laughter that is an external laughter, by hearing a joke, or watching a movie, or seeing some funny scene, That's a very negative laughter. It's not a good laughter. When a lot of people say, oh, laughter is very healthy, that's when it's coming from a holy place. If the laughter is coming from a very unholy place, then there's nothing positive in it. And that's the wrong laughter. That's not the laughter I should be focusing on. It's good now once in a blue moon to see something funny. People like seeing a funny movie or hearing a good joke. Once in a blue moon, it's good. But when the laughter, when the humor is coming from a negative place, then there's nothing good in it. It actually damages me. And you see that, unfortunately, especially in our generation, then people laugh when somebody else suffers. And even now, it manifests into the media that the most popular videos you'll find online now are videos of people falling or crashing. And these are the most popular videos. You'll go on YouTube or Facebook, the ones that have millions of views are the ones where people who are riding on a bike and falling in an embarrassing way, or jumping on a trampoline and the trampoline rips and they fall. And you know, and they even make competitions. What's the most ridiculous video? And somebody will go on a skateboard and fall and break his bones, and everybody laughs from that. So I know it's hard to resist when you see somebody falling in a very funny way, then people, their nature is to laugh. Which, when you're thinking about it, why are you laughing? The person now can hurt himself severely and you're laughing. So not you, I'm just saying that's how our nature works. So the nefesh that comes from the klipa, that's what causes me to laugh from all these simple things. Because I have a nefesh that comes from kedusha, nefesh de kedusha, and I have the nefesh that comes from tuma, the nefesh from klipa. The nefesh that comes from the klipa, that's what it's looking for. It's looking for somebody to fall now and for me to laugh. This is called leitzanut. So leitzanut is like clownery. I don't know if that's the right word to say it. But unfortunately, there's positive laughter and there's a very negative laughter. If I now make it my business to humiliate somebody because everybody around me is laughing, and I get some type of a pleasure because I'm the clown of the group, that's a very negative thing. That's even considered in some cases worse than murder. When I humiliate somebody in public and everybody around there is laughing on his account, I spiritually murdered that person.
What is the person laughing? Like, somebody's making fun of somebody, this has happened to me before.
If you're
making fun of me, but I think it's so funny because I think it's true.
That's a whole different scenario. Oh, okay. But the thing is that we're not going to start analyzing every little joke, what it affects. If I'm humiliating somebody on purpose and everybody's laughing and that person wants to kill themselves from the shame, that's spiritual murder. If we're all sitting in a room and we in a very light way make fun of ourselves and everybody's laughing and we see it in a nice way, there's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong to be able to see myself and to be able to laugh at myself. It's actually very healthy to do that.
Yeah.
Most people, when they're not able to laugh at themselves, comes from a very, very powerful ego, that they're not able to laugh at themselves. We're going to talk about a certain motion in a second, that it's important to be able to look at myself and see my faults and laugh at it. It means that I'm diminishing my ego. But I'm talking about when I humiliate somebody. And unfortunately, people, they get a kick out of humiliating somebody. Everybody's laughing. I'm now the star of the crew. And this person is humiliated right now. So laughter has two places where it can come from. It can come from a negative, very negative place, and it can come from a very positive place. If you remember, I'm sure you bench many times, and before we bench, before we say Birkat HaMazon, we read a Psalm of Tehillim, Shir HaMa'alot B'Shuv Hashem Et Shivat Zion. Hayinu Kecholmim, when Hashem is going to bring us back to Zion, to the state of, to the land of Eretz Yisrael, and when the coming of Mashiach. Then it says, Hayinu Kecholmim, we were as dreamers, meaning that this exile is going to look like a dream. And then we say, Az Yemales Chokpino. Then our mouth is going to be filled with laughter. Now, it's not that we're going to be cracking up from laughter, Rather, the joy within is going to come out to the surface, that all day long we're going to be like on this high. We're going to be laughing. Laughing is like the best thing ever. You can be depressed. Somebody's going to come and tell you a funny scene and you laugh. Suddenly all the pressure goes out. But this is a positive laughter. When Mashiach is going to come and we're going to realize that this exile was a dream and we're going to see what we achieved, then our laugh will be filled with laughter, and all day long we're going to be like walking around like on a high. This is the real laughter. The real laughter that comes from the depth of my neshama. Now, where do we learn that from? We learn that from a psalm of Tehillim. David HaMelech is very wise. And in the second psalm, in chapter 2, there's a certain verse that he says, Yeshev b'shamayim ischak, talking about Hashem. Hashem, Yeshev b'shamayim, Hashem sits in the heavens and he laughs. Now Hashem doesn't laugh what we think from a joke. It's this pleasure. This laughter comes from what's called ta'anug. Ta'anug, and I'm very happy. When you go and you see something that causes you a lot of nachat, you see your child in the wedding day and they chose a good spouse and everything sits well, you have this unbelievable nachat, then you have this, it's not a laughter, it's this unbelievable pleasure from within. You do something and you see the fruits of the labor. So it's talking that a Kadosh Baruch Hu is looking down at this world and he has this pleasure, this laughter. This is the laughter we're talking about. The sense of the month that is talking about laughter is not jokes. It's not getting drunk and laughing and making fun. It's this inner happiness that comes from within. Now, if you remember in the last couple of classes, I told you that if you're looking at a pie of the month, if we take a circle and we cut it into 12 pieces, like a pie, then there's always going to be one month in front of the other. So there's always the sense of the month that is in front of my month, that is in front of the month, of the sense of what I'm going through. So in this month, the month of Adar, the sense is laughter. The month that is in front of Adar, if you're looking at the pie, would be the month of Elul. Exactly. The sense of the month of Elul is the sense of maaseh, of action. So there's a connection between the action and between the laughter. Now, usually, whatever is the opposition is the completion. That's how it's called. Anything that is a nigud, whatever is going against, in most cases, that will be what allows it to be completed. That's why it says about Adam and Chava, when Adam HaRishon requested a wife, then Hashem says, "Evra lo ezer kenegdo." I'm going to create for him a helpmate that will be against him. Now Rashi explains, if he has the merit, then the wife will be an ezer, will be a helpmate. If he doesn't merit, she will be negdo, she will be against him. That's the literal explanation. But the more deep explanation is that whatever causes my completion is whatever is the opposite. That whatever opposes me causes my completion. The example for that is, take scissors for example. You take two blades of the scissors, what will cause the scissors to actually work is the fact that the blades are opposite from each other. That's how they will cut the paper. If the blades are not opposite from each other, or they don't touch each other, it will not cut. They must be. If you're looking at the actual blade, take a scissors apart, you'll see that the blade, one goes this way, one goes that way. They have to hit the opposite side in order to cut. If not, the scissors are worthless. This is one example out of many. But in order for me to have completion, is when something is the opposite. That's why in most cases, marriages, they think that they don't get along. Because they say, oh, she's completely opposite than me. Yeah, because she's completely opposite from you, that's the completion. The nigud, the opposition, that's the completion. Sometimes you see two people and you're like, oh, now we have a friend that he's looking for a wife, and we know of a girl, and both my wife and me says, oh, she's exactly like him, everything. So that's not a good match, because she's exactly like him. It's too much like him. It's like literally like they're twins. We're like laughing how they're so exact. So that's not a good match, because they're too similar. It has to be a complete opposite in order to fit well. So if you take it into the marriage life, my wife has to be the, I don't want to say the word against, because against sounds negative. I would say in Hebrew you would say against, neged. Neged means across, different. So if you look in the mirror, for example, if I lift my right hand, so the person in the mirror also lifts up a hand. But if the person, if you're looking in the mirror, the person in the mirror is lifting the left hand, not the right hand. So my other half, which is my mirror, has to be opposite. So everything in this world that is an opposite, a nigud, then that's what causes the completion. And that's a rule that you have to remember, that whatever opposes me, whatever goes against me, so to say, that's what will complete me.
Doesn't it say in Genesis when God created man that he had to make a wife to be against
him? That's exactly what I said. I just said it in Hebrew, Ezel Kenegdo, but that's exactly the point. So sorry for not translating, but that's exactly that Hashem says, I'm going to create for him a helpmate that will be against him. I just use my words. I don't know the translation, but that's exactly the concept. That the helpmate is when it's opposing, that it's against, so to say. In marital problems, the wife or the husband will come and say, he's driving me crazy because he's doing this and that. It's not what I like. It's not what I want. Yeah, but that's what you need. It's not what you like, but that's what you need. You need the other side to be opposite from you. Now, if you're going head to head, then will be a clash. If you realize that the friction from the other side is to make you operate better, then you accept that friction. That's why if you take now a match, if it doesn't have what to strike it on, the match will never light. You can hold the match like this all day long. It will not light. It needs to have friction with I don't know the material in English, how you say it, but how you call the material you have on a matchbox. It's called in Hebrew gofrit. Whatever, you know what I mean. You have to strike the match on the surface, and that causes the match to light. I don't know the name in English. So good. So now I'm nothing to be embarrassed for. So probably in Hebrew.
That's meaning that you have confrontation. Is that confrontation?
No, it's not a confrontation.
Striker, what is it?
Striker. Okay, it's not a confrontation, but I will call it now a striker. If I have a match now, and I'm going to hold the match like this, it will never turn on. It will never light. I need something to rub it against. To strike it against in order to ignite the match. So I will look something in my wife and it will be not what I like, but that's the striker. That's the, I like more calling it friction, because in Hebrew it's called chikuch. In order to create something, has to be chikuch. And in English, chikuch is friction. And a friction can be something negative, but also it can be something positive. So with a husband and wife, if I see the opposition of my wife as something that is going against me, then it will cause a fight. And usually that will come from my ego. It's not going to come from anywhere else. But if I see the opposition of my wife to become my friction, my striker.
Because you strike a match.
Exactly. Then I can do something positive with it. So everything in this world, whatever seems to me an opposition is actually a good thing. So going back to what we're talking about, the sense of Adar is laughter. The sense of Elul is Maaseh, is action, which means they're opposite each other. There's a connection between them, and we're going to find out in a second why. Now, usually, in order to really understand anything in this world, we have to go to the original. The original is, of course, the master of the universe, which is Hashem. Hashem has many names. In his holy names lies the secret of everything. The name that creates the world is the name of Yudke Vavke, the name of Havaya, of to create. In the name of Hashem, we already have the hint of how to relate with this opposition. Now, if you take the word of Hashem, it has a Yud, then it has a K, then it has a Vav, and then it has a K. We do not pronounce the word and we don't write the word. If you separate the letters and put them back together, so take two Hays, put them on one side, and then you're left with Yud and the Vav, and you put it on the other side. The K and the K, the two letters of Hay, they form the part that is called laughter. The Yud and the Vav, they form the maaseh, the action, this being serious. Because the opposite of laughter is being serious. So if I'm taking the two senses, so I have the sense of laughter and the sense of maaseh. Here we're going to call it seriousness, because something that is the opposite of laughter is me being serious. So two letters of Hashem, the hey and the hey, that's the source of laughter. The letters of Yud and the Vav, that's the source of being serious. Now, usually, when I would write the name of Hashem, I would write Yud, K, Vav, K. We're also known from many teachings of Kabbalah that Yud, K, and Vav, and K is called a ladder. That if you turn the word around, then Yud will be the beginning, then K, then Vav, and then He. That's the ladder, climbing up in the worlds, climbing up in the four worlds, in the dream that Yaakov had, the ladder. He was climbing from one word, one world to the other. So in the word of Hashem, Yud Kei Vav Kei, usually the Yud is going to be the beginning. Now we're going to switch it around and we're going to read it the other way around, starting from the Hey. Now, the last Hey is called Hey Tachtona, is the last Hey. The last Hey can also be called, as in many terms of Kabbalah, Hey Tata'a. A lower level hay. This represents the kid that is in us. We all have a kid in us. Now, if you take a kid, what is the most dominating thing in a kid? It's playing. Kids play. Kids are not serious. They don't learn. They don't work. They play all day long. That's what they want to do. This is called in Hebrew sha'ashuim, playful. A kid, he can be playful all day long, like a puppy. That's the dominating thing of a kid. And how do you say play in Hebrew? Mischak. Meschek. Has the exact same letters of tzchok. Tzchok. Because we don't write it with a tzaddik, we write it with a sin. Tzchok pino. So the motion of a kid is to be playful and to play and to enjoy the play. Kids, they only want to play. They don't want to do anything else. They can play all day long. Now, amazingly, if you notice, kids have no value of time. They don't know, I mean, a kid, you know, they can say, oh, a million years. They don't know, they don't have any value to time. You have a value of an hour, of a day, of a week. You take a kid now on vacation, that's their life. We're living on vacation. Summer vacation for them, oh, it was a million years. So they don't have any analogy of time, kids. You can take them they can be in the bathtub for an hour. You tell them it's time to go out. Well, I'm only here for a minute. No, you're here for an hour. So kids don't have any perspective of time. That means that even when they play, they don't have a perspective of you telling them, you're outside already for 3 hours. We got to go. No, I only started. We all have the motion of a kid in me. And kids, one amazing thing that kids have, every day they discover something. We already saw everything. Nothing is new. Oh, I've seen this, I've been there. For a kid, every day is an adventure. Wow. They discover life. Every day they discover something new, especially when they're real, real young. They'll discover, wow, look at this thing, and they'll mesmerize on this thing for hours. And the next day they'll discover another thing. And the next day, Abba, look at that. So kids constantly discover new things. If you dwell into the mind of a child, they don't have a concept of time. All they do is play. They enjoy everything. Kids laugh like that. That's the motion of a kid. Now, another good thing that kids have, kids see the world in a very positive way. Only adults see the reality, and then they derive from that reality that everything is dark and heavy and sad and failures. Kids don't see that. Kids see everything nice and pink until they get burnt, of course. And unfortunately, the reality is that if you put a kid now in a perfect environment on a deserted island, they will grow to be the most happiest, healthy human being. Put this kid in society when they see theft and deception and lying and violence and all this, they will grow unhealthy, physically unhealthy. Physically, I'm not talking right now emotionally. Physically, they'll grow unhealthy, and I'm not talking about being sick in their mind, and their entire view of the world will be negative. So kids, by default, they see the beauty in the world. They don't see the negative part in the world. They can see in any person the beauty in it, but not the negative. More than that, they see everything in a very positive way. The only negative thing that you can pull out from a child is that they have a tendency to make jokes on account of others. And you see that with kids, that they'll bully another kid. That's the only negative thing that you can pull out from a child, because all the things that we just said, they're all positive. Everything has to have something negative. So kids, unfortunately, they'll usually have some type of a drive to make fun of another kid. So when we're analyzing it, according to Hashem's name, in me I have this child that sees everything perfect, that doesn't see any negative in other people, that wants to be playful and to play, wants to laugh, wants to have joy, but it also has this little part in me that wants to make fun of somebody else. Let's continue, then we're going to put everything together. Next, I have, going backwards in the name of Hashem, I have the letter Vav. Vav represents the simcha that I have in a mitzvah. Kids, they don't enjoy doing mitzvahs. We teach them to do mitzvahs because we want them to get used to it. Kids do not enjoy doing mitzvahs. And maybe lighting the menorah, or I don't know, decorating the sukkah. Kids do not have pleasure in doing a mitzvah. They do not like going to shul unless there's a lot of candy there. So when I become a little bit more mature and I understand the concept of a mitzvah, I'm able to derive pleasure from the mitzvah. It might be hard, it might will come with a lot of yetzerara, but I will be able to enjoy a mitzvah. I will put tefillin on and I will get some type of pleasure from it. Why? Because I understand in my mind that my nefesh right now is getting an aliyah. That my nefesh is being connected to the Kadosh Baruch Hu. My soul is deriving something out of it. I might not feel it, but I will understand it. So the vav represents the simcha that I get in the mitzvah. And sometimes I will do something, and I will not necessarily see the benefit, but I understand the benefit. More than that, I understand that when I grow more mature, I understand that the God-fearing comes from a much deeper place. A child doesn't have Yirat Shamayim. Yirat Shamayim is meaning fearing Hashem, but fearing Hashem not being scared that I'm going to be hit. Is fearing in an awe, is respecting the Kadosh Baruch Hu. Children don't have Yirat Shamayim. Children, they have love to the Kadosh Baruch Hu. Once I develop myself and I mature myself, I can develop also this awe and respect to the Kadosh Baruch Hu. So this is represented by the letter Vav. Then I have another Hey, the next letter Hey. This corresponds to this laughter of what I said before of Azim Ales Chokpino, to the future. I know what's going to be coming in the future. What is my actions birthing in the future? This is a much more advanced level. This is even in the spiritual level, a much more higher level. You have to climb to that level because most people are not in this level. This level is called Mimut, or in the single tense, it's called Tam. Like on Yaakov Avinu, Ish Tam Yoshevo Alim. He was Tamim. This is a very high level in my Avodat Hashem that not a lot of people get to it so easily, is that I accept everything that is coming from the Kadosh Baruch Hu. Usually I do not. something bad happens to me, I do not accept that it's coming from the Kadosh Baruch Hu. I blame it on everybody. Something bad will happen in my life, then I will find all the excuses what to point the finger on instead of saying, no, it's from the Kadosh Baruch Hu. This is called the level of Tmimut. And you have to work real hard to get to this level, because in this level, you really have to diminish your ego. Because this level, if I chas v'shalom don't reach the level of Tmimut, this is the source of all sadnesses. Because if I am connected to Hashem in a very innocent way, I will never be sad. Because I understand that everything comes from the Kadosh Baruch Hu. This is a very high level of Avodat Hashem. If I don't acquire that level, then I will constantly have sadnesses. The business deal didn't work out, I will be sad. My kid is not going on the path that I want him to go, I will be sad. I don't have parnasa, I will be sad. I'm constantly going to be sad. The source of sadness comes from ego. I told you, we started learning the course of Tikkun HaMidot, and I told you that the highest midah in the negative part is geava, is pride. The positive side is Anmidat Anava, the attribute of humbleness. From the negative side, if I'm looking at the highest, at the original character trait, which is called Geava, pride, or in our terminology, ego, then if Chas V'Shalom I have pride, what would be the first level, the first generation that will be born from this pride? Will be anger and sadness. Atzvut and Kaas. These are the two next two midot, the character traits that will be born from Geava. And then of course, we went into length of it in our course, we didn't even finish, we just started, but how I'm birthing more midot. So the cause of sadness, the root of sadness, only comes from my ego, comes from my pride. If I don't have pride, I will never be sad. So, this comes from, if you can hold the questions to the end, we're almost done. When I feel that I deserve something, in Hebrew we say magirli, I deserve it. Why do you think you need it? Magirli. This comes only from my ego, that I think that I deserve something, that I think that I deserve something from society, I think I deserve something from Hashem, I think I deserve something from my wife. This can only come from geava, from pride. And this is going to be the source of all sadnesses, because when I don't get what I want or what I think I deserve, then I will fall into sadness. So this comes from me not being tamim, me not being tam, being very innocent and accepting from the Kadosh Baruch Hu. This comes from the depth of my neshama. This corresponds to the Hei Ila'a, to the second. I mean, if you're reading the name of Hashem from the Yud, it will be the first. This is that level, this level of Tmimut, that when I'm talking about the laughter, this Azim al-Eschok Pinu, this is where it's coming from. Now, the highest level that one can reach, this comes from the letter Yud. And again, if you're reading it in order, then it's the first. If since we're switching the orders, now it's the highest. Yud corresponds to what's called Toratcha She'ashuai, that your Torah is my pleasure. This is a level of like a tzaddik, that my pleasure is only by being connected to the Kadosh Baruch Hu. When I'm connected to the Kadosh Baruch Hu, I have pleasure. If I'm not connected to Hashem, I have no pleasure. I'm sad. That everything that I do, I have this unbelievable pleasure that comes from within. And where do you really see it? You see it with tzaddikim. It says, "As yitaneg alavaya." Then we're going to have this pleasure just by being connected to the Kadosh Baruch Hu. And we're all after pleasures. We are creatures that want to derive pleasure. So we're constantly after these pleasures. So I think that a good meal will give me some pleasure. I'm running after a good meal, a good vacation, a nicer car. Why? Because I need pleasures. So I can derive pleasure for something very mundane, and I can derive pleasure from the Kadosh Baruch Hu. If I'm deriving my pleasure from the Kadosh Baruch Hu, then this is the original pleasure. So, to kind of sum it up, as I have two senses that I can tap into. The sense of tzchok, of laughter, and the sense of being serious, of maaseh. The two first ones, they're more corresponding to me. It's action. So the first one is the lower level, which is like the kid in me. But the good kid, the good part in the kid is that it's innocent. And I can see the good in everything. And I can derive the good from everything. And I don't get uptight from the time. I don't have enough time to do this. I don't have enough time to do that. Chas v'shalom, I can use it to a very negative place, is laughing on the account of others. So when I want to apply it to my life, I need to take this level of action in me and to apply that, because most of us take the level of the child in me and apply it to the negative part. Is when I derive pleasure and when somebody else suffers. And if I have a problem, as sad as it sounds, if I have a problem, I will have some type of nechama, some type of calmness when I see somebody else having the same problem or worse than me. That's the unfortunate reality. And when I see somebody else suffering, then I'm like, okay, you know, Baruch Hashem, they're suffering and not me. Needless to say that kids, like I told you, the negative part is that they derive some type of pleasure when they see somebody else suffer. And we also have it in us. That's what will cause us to say Lashon Hara. That's what will cause us to chas v'shalom cheat or to lie. Because I want somebody else to suffer and not me. So I'm willing to steal or I'm willing to lie because I don't want to be the one who's suffering, but I don't care if you suffer. So that's the negative part in the child and in me. I need to take that and to transform it and to see only the positive in everything, like a child. Seeing positive in everything, learning like the child that learns every day something new, to be able to learn from everybody around me. David HaMelech says, Mikol milamdei haskalti, I have learned from everybody. So not to have this geava and this pride that, oh, I'm smarter than you, you need to learn from me. No, I can learn from you. I don't care from wherever you came. And I can learn from you and I can learn from everybody. If I can learn from everybody, then I'm like a kid. I'm broadening my horizons. I'm getting and receiving from everybody. So that's the first thing that I need to apply. The second thing is the maturity in the mitzvot. Like a person that starts enjoying the simcha of a mitzvah. When I take everything that I just told you by climbing, if I go by the levels of climbing in the ladder of the name of the Kadosh Baruch Hu, then first I apply that. Then I will apply the seriousness in the mitzvah. And then I need to start working on my own tmimut, of being humble in front of the Kadosh Baruch Hu, to be able to humble myself. If I humble myself, I will never reach any type of sadness. The point I want to take from that is that, not to overcomplicate it, is to understand that in the month of Adar there are two senses that I can operate. That's why you see that there's a nigudim, there's an opposition in Adar. Even in the sign, there's two fish. One goes this way, one goes this way. Everything in this month has two options. I can focus on the positive, and I can focus on the negative. The power that I can take from this month, that in this world is always the illusion of good and bad. That's why I told you in the beginning that we'll summarize it in the end. The letter of the month is the letter of Kuf. Kuf is the center of the word Shekel. I can take this month and direct it to the positive, see everything good, see the positive in everything, be humble in front of the Kadosh Baruch Hu to accept everything. That's what's going to make the laughter come out of me, not the sadness. But this month also has the power of the Shekel, that things in this world come as in a deception. And something that is good will be covered with a lie, and it seems like it's not good. You know, the Zohar calls this world Alma de Shikra, the world of lie. So I would look at this world. If I'm looking at it in my eyes, then I see this is bad, that person is bad, that person is mean. If I'm looking at it in the eyes of the child, everybody's nice, everybody's good, everybody's... And I know that I can't be naive and to think that a murderer is nice. Don't take my words out of context. I'm talking about the motion of taking the maaseh, of the seriousness that is neged, the motion of the sense of laughter, is that from that I can actually, if I take this seriousness, I'm able to derive this sense of laughter. That's why I separated the words, the letters that I told you that the Yud and the Vav of the Kadosh Baruch Hu, that's the seriousness, that's the maaseh, that's the action. If I apply that, then I'm able to derive the two letters of the Kadosh Baruch Hu, the Hey and the Hey, to pull out the laughter from me. Then doesn't matter what's going to happen to me in this world, I'm always going to be with a smile on my face. Doesn't matter what is my challenge, I'm still going to be able to reach to the depth of my neshama to pull the laughter out of it and see the good in it. And exactly like you said, I will be able to look at the situation and laugh from it. Now, I can look at a situation that is negative in my life, I will just fall into depression. And I will only see the negative part in it. But I can take the same exact sin and laugh at myself. Now, I told you yesterday, that the day before, that when we made Aliyah, we had like 9 months of torture, so to say. And I told you that you have to remind me one time to tell you all the stories. I just told you one part of it, of the day of the move. But another thing that happened, then again, you have to hear the whole story to really understand. But we found ourselves with nowhere to live. And we end up living in somebody's garage for 2.5 months. Now, it wasn't me, 17-year-old with a backpack. It was with a wife, pregnant wife, and 5 kids. So one might look at this situation as, oh my gosh, they're living in a garage. We had the best time of our life. I have videos of us dancing in the garage. Because you can look at a situation and fall into depression and sadness. And why is Hashem doing it to me? And why is this situation? And how did I find myself in this situation? And you can, like this, fall into depression. But you can look at the situation and, like you said, laugh at myself. If I know how to laugh at myself, first of all, it was a nice garage. Okay? It was... Excuse me?
Was it heated and cool?
First of all, it was in Los Angeles. We didn't need heat. If you look from the outside, it looks like a garage. Inside, it had a nice floor. It was a nice garage. Don't think that it was like, with the paints and the oil on the floor from the car. Somebody made a nice room, guest house in the garage. But it was still a garage with 7 people in it. We were like, at night, put all the mattresses on the floor. And in the morning, we had to lift up the mattresses, cover them, and put them on the side. But in essence, this could have been the worst time of our life. But it was the best time of our life. Because up until today, you ask my kids, what was the best time of their life? They'll tell you, when we all slept in that person's garage, because we were all together, and we were all sharing the same mattresses, and we ate like on a little table like that. And it was a very special time. And the thing is, you have to hear the entire story to understand what preceded it. That when you understand what preceded it, you're like, this garage was like a heaven. The point to take from that is the Kadosh Baruch Hu will put me through a series of events. Now, I can look at life in the eyes of a child and be like, wow. My kids were so excited. You know why? Because in our garage, the door was a big door. So kids see things in their point of view and they're excited. You can look at it as an adult and be like, oh my gosh, I'm in a garage. So, and the bathroom is outside. The point is that if I'm able to laugh at myself, I'm able to laugh at every situation in my life and see the beauty in it. And that's the level that I told you, the third level, corresponding to the letter Hey. It's that I'm humble. I'm innocent. Tamim. In Hebrew, tamim is innocent. Is that a child is innocent. Give now a child $1,000 toy, and on this next to it, a box that is not even, you can't even buy the box because some product came in that box. Wow, look at this box. And the child is not going to look at the expensive device. He will take a piece of plastic and will add a rubber band and connect something here. Oh, look what I did. So children see everything in a very innocent way. They don't need something to be too sophisticated. I need to take all these levels that I just dissected, coming from the name of Hashem, And when I recognize these levels in me, and I'm able to order them, put them in the right order, to be able to climb, I will reach the highest level that I'm just pleasuring on the Kadosh Baruch Hu like a tzaddik. I'm not going to see pain. I'm not going to see suffering. I'm not going to see anything negative if I go in the level. That's why I told you, if you take the word and you twist it like this, and now you have levels like a ladder, then you climb in the levels. And if I follow every little thing that I just told you, I know it was a little bit too much information, but watch the video and go to the rerun. Because if I apply this to my life, I will climb these levels one after the other, and I will reach the level that I'm so innocent in the eyes of the Kadosh Baruch Hu. I'm so humble in front of the Kadosh Baruch Hu that I will see the world in the eyes of a child, perfect. I will see the perfection in everything. I will not see the negativity in everything. Needless to say, I have to be cautious and aware not to direct it to the negative power of a child. That's why I told you this month is a very tricky month, because it has nigudim, two opposites, that can easily be deceived with the element of the month of this lie. The element of the month, I told you, is water. Water is also a lie. You can look above the water, it looks to you, wow, what a beautiful pond of water. Inside can be sharks and can be dangerous fish. Water can be also very deceiving. That's why I told you that water can also grow all the teavot, all the desires, because that's this something deceiving. And the letter of the month also is the kuf, is the sheker. It's on one leg. Easily, one leg can easily be swinging from side to side. So I have to, first of all, be aware to separate between the truth and the lie. And it's very, very hard, because the world is covered with lie. Everything has this a wrap of a lie. I need to be able to separate it. But I have to see how the opposition in everything in this world is the completion. And if I follow these levels, you will reach to the point that you have the innocence of a child. You see all the positive in everything. Every individual you deal with it in a very innocent way. You see the good in that person. I can pull the bad from every person in a second. It's very easy to come and say, she's a liar, she's a thief, he cheats. It's very easy to point the negative on a person. That's what we do. Now try to pull the positive from people. Try to look at a person and says, wow, she's so courteous. She's so polite. She's so charitable. She's so loving. That's very, very hard of us to do. In most cases, we judge people right away. We pull out all the negative. So if I go in these levels and then I apply the simcha, the pleasure in the mitzvah and so forth, no need to repeat, I will reach my ultimate happiness. That's why the month is the month of happiness. Then I'm able to derive this unbelievable laughter. And this is, again, not an external laughter. This is the deep, deep laughter that comes from the depth of my soul that will be experienced when Mashiach is going to come very soon. We're literally going to be walking in the streets high from laughter. We're not going to be laughing. It's just going to be this unbelievable, overwhelming joy that we're not going to be able to, well, now we can't contain such a thing. When Mashiach is going to come, we will be able to contain it. That's why we're doing mitzvot now, to be able to contain this high and not faint. So I want to apply in this month is, first of all, see the separation between everything. Because we do have a very powerful element in this month of sheker. That's why we get dressed in this month. That's why in Purim we have to get dressed. And the mitzvah is to be drunk, not to be able to distinguish between the evil Haman and the holy and righteous Mordechai. It has the element of this deception. But I need to be able to make this separation and see, okay, this is the right, the positive, this is the negative. This is the holy, this is the unholy. If you follow what I just told you now, I can guarantee to you, you will reach this depth of, this unbelievable depth of happiness that will allow to bring on you this unbelievable bracha that I said in the beginning, this unbelievable blessing, and needless to say, to reach the level that anything that you need a miracle in your life will come, because our life is full of miracles. We just don't realize that it's a miracle. We just take things for granted that, oh, it's supposed to. But the reality is that we're experiencing hundreds of miracles in our life. Dozens of miracles every day. We just don't notice it. But the point is to recognize it. And I can actually activate this level of receiving this unbelievable bracha, unbelievable miracles in my life, that the entire energy of this month is what's called v'nahafocho, will transform it. It will go from here, it will go the complete opposite. So even though we just started doing that in the middle of the month, usually we do the class in the beginning of the month, but you still have half a month to work on it. Now it doesn't mean that once the month of Adar passed that you let go. We have to take this teaching and apply it for the rest of the year. And to go by every step of what I just said now and to apply it into my life, I can guarantee to you, you're going to be a very happy person. I'm not telling you that your challenges in your life will disappear. They will still be there till the last day of your life or till the last moment before Mashiach comes. We will have challenges and we're going to have problems and we're going to have a lot of issues going on. But at least it's going to be with a smile on my face. And it's not going to be overwhelming. And it's not going to be hard. And it's not going to be growing because I make my own problems. When I have the right connection to the Kadosh Baruch Hu, my challenges, I take it with a smile. I'm able to laugh at myself. That's why when I'm in a garage for 2.5 months with a pregnant wife and 5 kids, it's beautiful. I love it. I'm bonding now with my family. I'm able to bond, you know, this is when our entire family bonded in such a way. My kids became such best friends. We were like in our own cocoon. So you can look at something in a very negative way, and you can look at something in such a positive way that's the point of being so humble. Then first of all, I don't think I deserve anything. That's what Hashem wants to give me? Good. I'm happy you gave me a garage and not a dumpster. I can look at it in a very negative way. Anything can look in a negative way and look in a positive way. Look, we're just talking and look at the sun, how it comes out. Just like that. You can look at it and say, well, what a horrible, miserable day. It was raining and dark and gray. Look, I'm just talking. We're just changing the energy and the sun comes out and says, see, you can look at everything in a very positive and a very good way. So this is the power that I want to derive out of this month. That in a split second from having a gray day and a depressing day, I have a sunny day. And that's everything in my life. And everything in my life, I can look at it in a very negative way and dwell in it and sink into the sadness and the depression in it like an ocean of water. An ocean can be extremely depressing if you're looking at it from below. If you're looking at the ocean from below, it's dark. Cold, you know how cold it is down there? How dark it is? It's depressing. But you can look at the ocean from above, you see the waves and the sun and I can be now on a beautiful beach in Mexico. Anything in this world can be looked from the negative side and from the positive side. And you can wake up today in the morning was a, so to say, a miserable day because it was raining and gray, and hop, Hashem can change it in one second. All he needs to do is move a cloud. And now it's a sunny day. A beautiful, sunny, warm day. This is the power that I can take from the month of Adar, that everything that is negative in this world is a lie. It's not true. It's the sheker, the lie of this world, that the world in Hebrew calls olam. Olam comes from the word helem, to conceal, to cover. So I see everything in this world is very, very negative. It's not negative. I just need to move the cloud, and whoop, I see the beauty in it. And the more I humble myself, the more I don't think I deserve anything, that's when things start shining even better. And that's where our sages say, Ezehu Ashir, who's a person who's rich? Hasameach bechelko, who's happy. Sameach is happy. Doesn't say a merutzeh, is satisfied, or any other word. It says sameach. Why? Because when you really understand how rich you are, then you're happy. That's the real happiness. That's this happiness that comes from the depth of an neshama. Why? Because I don't need anything in this world to make me happy. Because Hashem makes me happy. Tov li Torah at picha ma'alfei zahav kesef. The Torah of the Kadosh Baruch Hu is better than any gold or silver or anything. That's the true happiness. So any moment that I feel sadness in my life, it's only because I'm not connected to the Kadosh Baruch Hu, that the lie of the world is affecting me, that I am now sold by the deception. If the deception is not affecting me, it means I'm connected to the Kadosh Baruch Hu. That's why I told you that the next level, the Hey and the Vav, the Hey and the Yud, that's this ultimate happiness, that I'm humble in front of the Kadosh Baruch Hu. And bottom line, that's what I want. I want to be happy. I don't care how, I want to be happy. And we're creatures of pleasure and happiness. And this is the motion. This is the pattern that if I will now follow it, I will be able to reach to this unbelievable happiness in my life. Needless to say that if I apply all that, just to apply this positive energy, this will be the ultimate happiness that we'll experience when Mashiach is going to come, and then we're really going to be able to say, Azim aleschok pino. Bezat Hashem, we wish you to have a beautiful and laughing, happy rest of the month. If we're able to reach to that level, comes the next month, is the month of redemption. The month of Geulah, the month of Nisan, where we go out of exile. Bezat Hashem, with our positive attitude, we'll be able to transform everything negative in this world, to be able to declare, Azim aleschok pino. Our mouth should be full of laughter, should be laughing happily ever after, like in the fairy tales. But this is going to be the reality, not the fairy tale. And Zazat Hashem, this should hasten the Geulah. Should have a beautiful rest of the month. Amen.